the amazing way that God loves us. Here we are on this Valentine's, you know, weekend, and isn't it great to know that the love of God is so amazing? Amen. There's no greater love than the love that comes through Jesus Christ. So we're glad to have you in worship today as a part of our special Sunday with our Scout Sunday for worship. We had a wonderful 8:30 worship service, and I look forward to our time here at 11 o'clock. Let me go over several announcements here. As you open up your bulletin, the first you'll see at the bottom of the inside is that our family fellowship meal has been moved from this Wednesday, the 16th, to the 23rd. So we're just moving that back a week. If you're already signed up, you're in good shape. Just plan on coming the 23rd. We have our breakfast for dinner night. And be a wonderful time together. And there's still time. If you'd like to sign up since we moved it back, please let us know by next Sunday, the 20th. You can even fill that out today and put that in the offering plate when you leave church today. On the back of the bulletin, again, we've been sharing about if you'd like to volunteer with mission trips, help out with disaster training, then call the numbers you see there in that announcement. Our confirmation class begins today. We're excited about that journey of faith that those students will take. We'll be meeting 3:45 over in our social hall, going to 5:30. Willing Workers Circle will be meeting Tuesday, the 22nd of February, so take note of that. Our Ash Wednesday service that begins our season of Lent leading to Easter, that's coming up on March the 2nd. And then also something you may or may not be aware of, but we want to encourage you to collect your cans, your aluminum cans, and collect those, break them down for us. But if you will put them out, there's a container by the playground. We collect those, and then several times during the year, we've got some folks in the church. We'll take those off, and you'll see in that announcement that through the cans that were in there, $240 was collected. That money goes to support Mission on the Move, one of our ministries in Tapachula, Mexico, and supporting them. And so I want to encourage you to be a part of that. I'm sure there will be a lot of cans drunk tonight watching the Super Bowl, all right? So save those, bring them to church, and we can use those, all right? If you brought soup cans with you today, remember we've been collecting soup cans as a way to support Manna House in our local community. If you have those when the church service is over, you can take them out in the hallway behind the sanctuary here. And you can pick whether you want to put those in the Bengals box or the Rams box. I will say that right now, our church family seems to believe and be cheering for the Bengals to win the Super Bowl tonight. So anyway, just a little heads up on that. And then finally, you may have also brought some candy with you today, maybe some different vitamins related to vitamin C, multivitamins for our Maritime Bethel outreach. If you brought any of that stuff today, you can take it and put it up by the front door as you're leaving church here today. But y'all were so happy, so thankful to be together in worship. And if you'll join me this morning, let me just lift up a prayer to the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, there is no one else like you. You alone are God. You are Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You are here with us. You come to bring your peace. You come to bring your love. You come to lead us in the fullness of your eternal life. And we just glorify your name today. We thank you for every person who's here. Lord, you created them. Lord, you gave your life for them, Jesus. And you want each one of us to live our lives fully for you. We pray right now this morning that you will receive all the honor and glory and praise. As all that is done to glorify you. We ask your blessing now. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let me invite you this morning to please stand as our scouts come to present the colors this morning. Also in your bulletin you will find an insert that has the different pledges that we will do to the American flag, the Christian flag, and also to the Bible. The scouts will now lead us in this next time.
pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word, a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Its words will I hide in my heart, that I might not sin against God.
Well, good morning. Please remain standing, and you may pull out your hymnal. Turn to hymn 77. We'll have the words in the hymnal up on the screen this morning. We're going to sing "How Great Thou Art," 77.
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power.
back in your hymnal to hymn 371. 371. We'll sing "I Stand Amazed in the Presence."
Thank you. so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm part of the family of God.
You may be seated.
Y'all, it's such a wonderful spirit of joy here today. What a blessing that is, the joy of the Lord, and just his presence here amongst us, the blessing to be able to see one another. And again, we're so thankful to be able to worship Jesus with you today. We head into our time of prayer this morning. I want to share with you some different prayer requests. This morning is that Mr. Earl Thrift, he is now in the presence of Jesus. He has been battling his cancer, and on Friday things took a turn, and early this morning he was face to face with the Lord. And when we were singing that song, "Oh How Marvelous, Oh How Wonderful Am I Song Over Thee," that's the song he's singing now in the presence of Jesus. Amen. We're so thankful for his witness of Christ. And so, you know, I talked to probably, you know, four or five people in the last 24 hours about Earl. And each one, when you would mention his name, they'd be like, "Man, he is such a kind, godly man." I mean, you know, isn't that how you want to be known, church family? That you want to be known as a kind, godly person who lived your life. Like, there wasn't any hesitation from anybody going, "Are you talking about Earl Thrift? Are you sure?" You know, when you use those words, we all know that when you speak, that was a kind, that he is a kind, godly man, that is true. So we thank the Lord for his witness to us. We pray for his family and God's comforting grace to them in the days that will come. Also, Johnny Mitchell in our church, he and Christy, Johnny's daddy is now in the presence of the Lord as of Thursday. He is home with Jesus. They have a funeral today. Mr. John also lived a wonderful life for God, a great blessing and witness of his family and beyond. If you will especially keep them in prayer, that is two close family members within the month now who have died, between Johnny's brother and his daddy. So please continue to hold them in prayer as they remember Mr. John today. Tim and Cheryl McDavid in our church family. Tim, I shared that he had a brain bleed a week ago. He was in the hospital. He is now at Encompass Health in Savannah, and they are working with him. Had a good visit with he and Cheryl yesterday. He is extremely weak on that side where it impacted him. He's got a little movement, so we want to press into the power of Jesus to heal, to strengthen, and to use that great team down there to help him in this process. But they were in good spirits. Also, Miss Lynette Jones, continue to pray for Lynette's strength as she was in the hospital and in physical therapy, just the building back up of her health. Again, we're so thankful today for Troop 295, B&G. Glad to have you all in worship. Thankful for the ministry that you're a part of each and every week and the special things you get to do. Be in prayer for the Manna House and all those in our community. We have several wonderful feeding ministries in our community. The canned food we collect will go to Manna House this time, but be in prayer for those there and lift them up in prayer. Obviously, continue to pray for our nation as well as the world right now as things continue to increase in conflict between Russia and Ukraine and how that impacts us and others in the world. We know that God is in control. We pray for him to move in these moments, and so we need to be pressing into prayer for that. Continue to pray for our church family as we continue just to seek the leading of the Lord and his constant guidance in our church. So, any other prayer requests you want to share today or celebrations of the grace of Jesus?
Family of Ann Crawford.
Say it one more time.
Ann Crawford, the family.
The family of Ann Crawford.
Her husband is leading the next carriers.
She passed away. Okay. Yes.
Praying for her since she found out she's a very dear.
Quinta shared a praise today of a friend of hers in high school, which was not that long ago for Quinta.
That's right.
But a friend in high school who was told that she would never be able to have kids, and she is now in her second trimester with a baby boy. So that's a great praise to the Lord. Amen. And we'll continue to pray for her. Amen. He also had triple bypass surgery this week, and the Lord has brought him through that. So we thank the Lord for each Brian and Kenny, how they were brought through. Zedna?
My son-in-law was operated on Wednesday for cancer, and he's doing fine at home.
And who was that again?
My son-in-law, Eddie.
Your son-in-law, Eddie, that's right. He's back home again?
Yeah.
After, and he's cancer-free?
Well, we don't know about that.
All right, that's what we're praying into. That's right. Well, we will pray into Eddie and God's care for him. But thankfully, he's home. Amen. Okay. Y'all, let's pray together for a moment. As we do, I want to invite us to think about the marvelous, the wonderful love of Jesus for you and me. Would you begin just quietly to begin to praise the Lord? Just to say, Father, thank you for the way that you love us through Jesus. Thank you for how wonderful you are to each and every one of us in this room. We don't deserve the kind of mercy, the grace, the love that you give us. But Lord, we thank you today for how marvelous it is the love of Jesus Christ, who died on the cross so that we might have your righteousness, Jesus, that all of our sins would be washed away, and that we'd be born again into new people, people of God. Lord, so marvelous, so wonderful is the love of the Lord. Father, thank you for the marvelous and wonderful way that you break through, Lord, with just answers to prayer. Lord, we thank you for Quinta's friend today celebrating a baby boy, second trimester, when there seemed like that would never come. Lord, we just give you praise today for that precious boy, what he means to his family, and Lord, to all who know him, and your plans for his life. Father, today we thank you, Lord, for the way that you have brought Brian and Kenny through very intense surgeries this week. And we pray that their hearts and bodies would heal, and that, Lord, they give you all the honor, glory, and praise for what you have made a way of help for them. Lord, we continue to come today, and we lift up to you, Lord, your strengthening of healing over Tim and your encouragement to he and Cheryl. Lord, for Lynette, raise her up in the strength of your life. God, we thank you for what has been given to support Manor House, and we pray that for them and other ministries in our community that are helping to feed the hungry, may they not only feed bodies, but may you use them to feed the soul as well, Lord. Today, Jesus, we continue to ask, and we thank you for Eddie being home. And Father, we just speak in the name of Christ, Lord, healing over him, removal of any cancer cells, that they would be gone through the blood of Christ. Father, we lift up precious families to you today. We think about the witness of Christ and Earl Thrift, Lord, and John Mitchell. Each of them who lived faithfully to honor you, who set a godly example in their families. And Lord, we thank you for the way that our lives have been blessed by Christ through them, through the wonderful, marvelous love of Jesus that they allowed to flow through their lives. Lord, for both the Thrift family, for the Mitchell family, we pray you comfort them right now in the midst of their mourning and all who love them. Today, God, we acknowledge again that in this room, there are many praises, and we give you the glory for them. And Father, there are many prayer requests as well. Father, you know what that need is. You know, Father, how to care fully in your divine support and grace towards them and us. And Father, you know how to make your way. So Lord, lead us again today in what we don't know of how you may work in these moments of our lives, to trust that you are faithful to be who you are, Almighty Father, loving Savior and Lord, constant guide and strength and the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, Lord, unite us as one people. Lord, we want to pray over our nation today. We pray for there to be true godly wisdom given and, Lord, received by our president and, Lord, for military leaders. We pray for military right now being shifted to new areas in preparation for possible combat. We pray for them and their families that, Lord, you would steady them in what is unknown. That, Lord, you would lift them up to trust in how you can work in these moments. Jesus, we believe and know that you are able to bring peace in the midst of the power struggle that is taking place right now. And so, Lord, we pray for the miracle of a divine intervention from you, Lord. To calm the nations of Russia and the Ukraine and all nations impacted by these moves. Lord, we want to thank you that you are the one who's in control of all things. And that we can fully rely upon you and trust you. We thank you, Jesus, that you are a forgiving Savior. So, Lord, today we confess our sins, knowing that you are faithful and just to forgive us of all sin, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now I pray, Jesus, would you lead us in the prayer that you taught your disciples in praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Children, I want to invite you to join Miss Amy now for Children's Church today. And as you're doing so, Quinn is going to come and bring forth special music with Melissa to worship the Lord. Thank you, Quinn. And thank you so much, Melissa. Amen. Wonderful blessings there. I'm going to invite Michelle Patterson to come up at this time. So thankful for Michelle and Frank, just who they are as lovers of Jesus, who they are as members of our church, and the ministry that God has called them to be a part of through the Scouts. And so thankful to have y'all here today, and I'll let you take the lead.
Thank you very much. We do come today, Scout Sunday, just to say thank you very much for your support over the years. Just a little bit of history here. I serve as your charter organization rep, which means I'm the go-between between the church and represent the church in the program. It's a ministry for my family, has been. Our current paperwork shows that we will approach our 30 years of having scouting ministry. It's alive and well in Effingham County. There are a lot of units here represented in this church, not only 295, but we have 665 represented in this church and 650. So there's several units of scouting that's represented in this church. But we do thank you for your continued support. We couldn't do it without you. It's ministry for us. It's often a silent ministry because you don't see us a lot. But we are a ministry that takes place outside the doors of the church. And so it's very important. Currently, last time I pulled a roster, we have had 73 Eagle Scouts that have earned Eagle Scout rank out of Troop 295. And we currently have possible two to board and maybe even six this year. So today, two of our youth are going to share with you what scouting has meant to them. One of our younger scouts, Alex Bryant, a very cheerful young man, always willing to step up and lead, always willing with a smile on his face to do anything that you ask him to do. And Alex and his family are here with us today. And we also have Marissa. Marissa's one of our quiet ones that really struggles to speak forth, but she is one of those leaders that leads quietly. She's very strong. She has a lot of leadership qualities, and sometimes these things are challenging for us. She doesn't believe me, but I used to be like that before scouting. Scouting helps you a lot to become a stronger, better person. So today, I invite Marissa Mahoney and Alex Bryant, if you will come up here with Kenneth, and we will allow you to share with us what scouting has meant to you.
Like Ms. Michelle said, I'm Alex. I'm a Tenderfoot Scout in Troop 295. I've been in Boy Scouts for 2 years, and before that I was in Cub Scouts for 5 years. I've learned a lot of helpful skills during my time in scouting. I've learned things from knots to first aid. I've also met some great people during my time in Scouts. I've met people who have changed my life for the better by teaching me things that I never would have known without scouting. Scouting is a big thing in my life and is very often thought about when planning family events. We try to work around scouts to the best of our ability. Scouting has really changed my life for the better. Without scouting, I would never have known to maybe save somebody's life after a car accident by doing basic first aid, or how to survive in freezing temperatures without water or food. It has also helped me be more physically active and become a better chef. One of my friends I met through scouting, even after we went to separate troops, we are still friends and see each other daily. Scouting is one of the things I love to do, and I'm going to work as hard as I can to achieve my Eagle. Scouting is not just some hobby that I have, it is a major part of my life that can really improve my life in the future. We have also been on some really great trips in my time during scouting. In the summer of 2021, we went to Camp Durant in South Carolina. It was a very nice camp, and I met some great teachers and kids. I also grew closer with the members of my troop during that week-long camping trip together. Another really cool place is when we went to camp on the section of the Hoopi River. When we were there, we kayak and canoe down the river. Next weekend, my patrol is going on a camp out to Charleston. While we were there, we are going to the Charleston Aquarium in Fort Moultrie. This camping trip has been special for me because I have had to plan the whole thing, which has helped me realize how to be thrifty when looking for places to camp and visit. One thing that our troop does is we have little envelopes with money inside for us to use on scouting-related things. This is part of being thrifty and us paying our own way, which is a big thing in Scouts. Doing this has made me more responsible with my money and probably my money in the future. These are things that scouting means to me.
Hello, my name is Marissa Mahoney. I am a Star Scout in Troop 295G, and I'm the Assistant Senior Patrol Leader. I've been involved in scouting since I was 5 years old because of my brother. He joined when he was 7. And even though I couldn't actually join scouting because it wasn't open to girls back then, I still remember when my brother first crossed over into Boy Scouts, I wasn't really able to be involved in the troop. And I was really disappointed that I couldn't do anything, go on trips, because that's what I really love to do. And I told him, and when it was open for girls to join, I told my parents I would join with little to no hesitation, because it's played an important role in my life for a very long time. And I've met many people that have become important and learned multiple life lessons on how to be a better person for those around me. Our troop goes and helps out in the community as well as doing different things such as conservation projects. And we go on multiple camping trips throughout the year, as Alex said. And my personal favorite one is 2 or 3 years ago when we went on Labor Day weekend. There was supposed to be a hurricane, and there were less people there than what there normally is. We went, and as Alex said, we went down the river in canoes and kayaks and cleaned up the river by picking up trash along the way. I made a lot of good memories, and as I said, I don't remember exactly which year it was, but I have this picture in my room somewhere, and there's about 7 of us, and we're balancing on a tipped over canoe. It brings back a lot of memories. We also went on this one camping trip in my first year of scouting. It was one of the first camping trips that I went on as an official scout. And it was a cookery, and we had to cook, five different ways to cook meals. And that allowed me to learn different ways to cook because I did not know how to cook at all. I knew nothing. And I applied what I learned there on other campouts. My second favorite camping trip ever was this past year, summer camp in North Carolina, Camp Durant. I was able to, I'm pretty much repeating what I said, but I met a lot of new people and learned a lot of things. I talked with people that I really didn't know. And as Ms. Michelle said, I'm usually quieter than most people in the troop. Similarly to that, 2 years ago, or not 2 years ago, first 2 years that I crossed over into Scouts, I was the senior patrol leader for the girls' troop. First year, I was not able to communicate with anyone very well, and I wasn't experienced leading others, because I pretty much always worked alone for most of my life. The second year that I was senior patrol leader, however, I was able to lead with more knowledgeable decisions. I'm more social now with people that I don't know, and it isn't as awkward for me to talk and make conversation. Now when I'm speaking to you guys. If I tried to do this a few years back, I really wouldn't have been able to. Doing multiple activities outside of scouting can be difficult sometimes because I have scouting school, marching band, and volleyball, and scouting has helped me learn to manage my time wisely. Since it's been a big part of my life for most of my life, and it's helped me multitask between different events coming on in my life. But as I said, it can be difficult sometimes. It's also taught me to care and want to help people more, and how to lead in a way that people understand what I'm saying and doing. just working better together with other people in general. I've learned other things as well, such as, like, as I said, how to cook and first aid. Yeah, that's pretty important. And it's people like you guys that help us do everything we do, so thank you.
Thank you so much, Alex, Marissa. You guys did a great job this morning. And are the both of you, are you so thankful that you're part of scouting? And that's what I heard you say today. That are you different people today? Like, do you feel like you're more confident in certain things? And that's such an amazing thing. So we're so thankful for y'all today. Alex, you said you've learned how to cook. Like, have you shared that gift with your family? You know, there, y'all have tasted and it's all right. That's awesome. So thank y'all for sharing here today. And for all those who are helping with scouting, thank you so much for that tremendous godly example that you share. And just so thankful for y'all's hearts today. I'm going to invite Kenneth Bennett to come up now. Kenneth has been a part of the Scouts since he was young. Came up through our troop and the leadership under Frank and Michelle, both as a scout, and then now today he is an assistant scout master. His parents are Mark Renee Bennett, that you may know, and then also his wife is Whitney. They are members over at Compassion Christian and very active in their church, serving on Sundays. And this past Monday, Kenneth and I met in person while Frank was on the phone with us, and just had an opportunity to hear Kenneth just share about his love for Jesus, how much he has a great time being part of the ministry of Scouts. And so Kenneth is here. He's going to share the Word of God with us today. That's why he's here, is to not just talk about scouting, which is awesome, but to bring in the power of God's Word with that too. So we're thankful that Kenneth is here. Something that I enjoy learning about Kenneth this week, about he and Whitney, is that they were in a position where they adopted a little girl. And shortly after that, learning that that was going to go through, they found out that they were pregnant. And so they have two young girls about the same age, and so neat on that. And they are currently adopting a little boy. And so that says a lot about who Kenneth and Whitney are in living for Christ and the way they trust the Lord with their family and life and how they seek to honor Him. So we're so thankful you're here today. It's a blessing on that. Let me pray over you today. Y'all pray with me. Father, just thank you so much for this morning. Again, we thank you for Marissa and Alex and them getting up to stand up and to share how much they love, how they have been taught and encouraged, and how they're growing in confidence being a part of scouting. Lord, I thank you for Kenneth. Lord, his life is one touched by you, Jesus, and he is here today to lift up what it means to be a person dressed in the full life of Christ. So, Holy Spirit, anoint him right now to preach your word, to do so with power and with peace. Lord, we pray in the name of Christ. And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you, Pastor. And thank you, church, for giving us the opportunity to come so that y'all can see one of the ministries that y'all support. We feel that it's important for y'all to see us and for our scouts to see y'all. And if you're joining us live on Facebook, we're glad you're here too. You are also part of the service, and we want to make sure you feel welcome. This morning, I'm going to talk about the armor of God. Not just a couple of pieces. We're going to talk about the full armor, the whole armor, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, the whole armor of God. We're going to understand as to why it's important to have all of those pieces. As I was preparing for today, I was thinking about, well, you know, how could this be, you know, essential for scouting? You know, what can I do to bring scouting into this? And it was really simple. There are also some certain things that scouts need to be ready for a camp out. Just like we as Christians need to be prepared for life, scouts need to be prepared for a weekend camp out. So we're going to go through, and you're going to see some different pieces as to what we might need for a weekend camp out. And the key part of this is the whole armor. We don't need just the boots or the shield or, you know, any one part. We need all of it. That's one of the things that Paul talks about. We'll get into that. We'll start with verse 10 right there in Ephesians chapter 6. It says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand the schemes of the devil." Paul says this, and he says it to the believers. This isn't just to the people in Ephesus. This is specifically to the believers in the church there in Ephesus, is to put on the whole armor of God. He also tells them to be strong, but not just physically strong. They need to be supernaturally strong, spiritually strong in the power of God. He says that because we can't do the things that God has called us to do as Christians in our own strength. We have to have that help from God on high. Amen. So he tells them to put on the strength and use it. And then he goes and says to put on the whole armor of God. And so I've talked a little bit about that. What would happen if a soldier came only with his sword or just his shield or only his shoes? He wouldn't be prepared. He wouldn't be ready. So too for our scouts. If they only came with just a few pieces, Mr. Sean or Mr. Owen would be like, "You forgot this. You kind of need this. This is important." So from my time in the service, I know that when we were told to come with full battle rattle, to bring everything. Everything you had to have it. If you didn't have it and they knew you had it, you're going to get in some trouble. It might start out as having to do some sort of physical activity, but if you continue to not have certain pieces of equipment or one piece altogether, they would eventually sit you down and be like, "Okay, so here's a written statement that says you're not doing what you're supposed to do. You keep on, you could lose rank, or we can put you out. Start doing what you're supposed to do." He then says to be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. I'm going to start painting a picture here with some pieces so that you can see what I'm talking about. Imagine a Roman soldier. He's standing in front of you, and his commander has said, "Stand," or "get ready," "stand against," "dig in" will be a more common term. Is he going to put down his sword, set his shield off to the side? No. He's going to have it up. He's going to have it ready. He's going to get his feet shoulder width apart. He might even stagger a little bit. His shield's going to be up. His sword's going to be ready so he can push. Now, we move on to verse 12 and 13. It says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." Paul doesn't change here. He keeps going. Because our fight with the supernatural, the devil, and everything he throws at us every day, it's a very close fight. I liken it to when a Roman soldier is put into a formation, he is put in that position, in that formation, and that's where he is. He doesn't get out of it. He is surrounded, and I know we've all seen the movies where they stack the shields all together and they make this big old giant wall and it just moves as one piece, right? When a Roman soldier fights, he fights together. But we as Christians, sometimes we have to be fighting alone. And we can't do that without the power of God. So it's like an amateur wrestling match. He shifts back to the look of the soldier in verse 13. And he says, "Therefore take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." In verse 14, he says, "Stand therefore, having fastened the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness." So we begin this putting together of the soldier's armor. And the first piece listed in verse 14 is the belt of truth. For our scouts, I have designated the backpack as what would be the parallel there. Scouts, when we come to a camp out, we've got a backpack and it's got most of our stuff in it. But the thing about that is that a soldier can't come to battle with just his belt. Okay? He's got to have his other pieces. If a soldier came to battle with just his belt, he wouldn't fight and win, right? I mean, it's just a piece of, this is canvas, but at the time, I believe they were leather. And most of us wear a leather belt. They keep our pants up around our waist and from falling down. But the soldier's belt, it had several purposes. First of all, it held his breastplate in place so that when he was turning, his breastplate didn't fly all over the place and expose his vital organs. It kept the leg coverings from the waist to the feet in place. They were all kind of tied together with leather straps. So it held everything in place so that they were completely covered. It was the cornerstone of the soldier's armor. Paul calls it the belt of truth. We have to have some truth as Christians about us. In verse 14, he continues on and he says, add the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate, I couldn't find one. I searched high and low to fill that gap with other than a piece of aluminum, but I couldn't do it. So we've got a breastplate of aluminum. The breastplate, like I said, for the Roman soldier, was held on with the belt. For our scouts, our breastplate would be our sleeping bag. It kind of protects us from getting cold at night, but it doesn't really cover a whole lot else. The breastplate is called the breastplate of righteousness because it's more than just being right. It's morally right. So you have to have these pieces on, all of these pieces on, to stand and fight. Now, like I said earlier, our soldier with just his belt wouldn't fight and win, right? Neither would our soldier with just his breastplate. Now, his vital organs are protected, sure. But if it's not held down, it could fly up and get in his face, and his vital organs could be exposed, and he could be attacked there. Christians, if we don't have on our moral righteousness, we could be exposed and be attacked. Our next piece, as we move on, in verse 15, it says, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. The shoes, I brought my old military shoes. I've had those since 2007. They are completely worn out. I get asked frequently if I need new shoes. The Roman soldier's shoes, they were kind of the forefront for today's athletic cleats. They had tabs in the bottom of them spread out over the place so that they could grip the earth better. But they also laced up to the ankle. It was a piece of leather that had straps, and they would lace up to the ankle to keep the ankle from rolling and breaking. So then for our scouts, scouts have to have some way to see, so we have a flashlight. Our scouts use a flashlight a lot. When we go to the family scout freeze out, which we just had a few weeks ago, we always tell them, hey, make sure your flashlight's close at hand so you can see, because we got to get our stuff set up and we're going to be setting up in the dark. So too, Christians must use our feet to march forward the gospel of peace. And it helps us to progress into the Word of God. Not just moving it forward and telling other people, but it helps us to dig into God's Word. Verse 16, he says, in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Our shield is very simple. Put it up there. The Roman soldier's shield was about 3 feet tall. It weighed about 20 pounds. It was very lightweight compared to the rest of everything he would have on him. including his sword and spear and everything else. So, and why do I bring that up? Well, because our faith is easy to carry. We don't have to lug it around in a backpack or in a trunk or a car. It's right there in our heart. We have our faith. For scouts, we have to have some protection too, right? We have to have a first aid kit. This first aid kit, I love this little first aid kit. My wife got it for me for Christmas, and it came with two of the extendable little poker things for fires to do marshmallows and hot dogs. And it all with a note that said, "Daddy, teach us, help us make marshmallows and s'mores." And I looked at my wife and I said, "Are we foreshadowing with the first aid kit?" And she laughed at me. But the first aid kit for the scout helps us to provide aid for those who need it, to protect them from what has injured them. On our scout campouts, if we can't find our little one that we have, you know, most of us should have in our pack, we always have one that hangs on our dining fly. It's about 2 foot wide. It's white. It's got a big red cross in the middle of it. And everybody knows that's the first aid kit. We just went through a couple weeks ago and took some expiring things out and made sure it was all up to date. But there's something that I left out there, you notice. He says, in all circumstances. All circumstances. Every day, every time, we must pick up our faith and have our faith close at hand. Our next piece is the helmet. Now, I would like to make a disclaimer. I went to South Effingham High School, and I graduated from South Effingham High School, and the senior gift from the football team was helmets. So that's why you're greeted by these lovely colors today. Anyways, so the helmet. The helmet protects the head, right? Our soldier, if he were to take and get smacked in the head, it wouldn't hurt that much. His head is protected. Our knowledge is protected. For our scouts, we have a hammock or a sleeping bag. And that's my hammock. I use a hammock. Some of the scouts use tents, excuse me, not sleeping. So you can see that the scout is now more protected from the elements when they go to sleep at night. Their gear is covered up by something so that it's not getting wet in the rain or getting snowed on if we ever end up getting snow again in South Georgia. So, but our soldier, if he comes with only his helmet, is still not prepared. Neither is our soldier who comes with only his shield. You have to have all of the armor, the whole armor of God. Our last piece is the sword. It says, and take, verse 17, we'll go back, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The sword of the Spirit, the Bible, every day reading it, digging into it. There's a lot of reasons why this sword, the Bible, is offensive to people. Somewhere else, somebody likens it to a two-edged sword. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And that's because a two-edged sword, it cuts going in and it cuts coming out. And if you were attacked by someone who had a two-edged sword in that time period, there was honestly no help. So too, this Bible, our sword, cuts and it offends people. And that's why they don't like it. It's because they're offended by it, because they know in Revelation it says that they will be judged according to it. And that's why they don't like it. Now, our soldier, again, he can attack somebody, but he has no protection. He isn't covered. But when our soldier puts on his helmet, his breastplate, his belt, his shoes, and he picks up his shield and wields them properly, He is prepared for any battle that may come. And that is why the whole armor is important, because you are completely covered from head to toe without any gap. Finally, for our scouts, got to have something to eat with, right? And our troop, we tell our scouts, bring your mess kits. And that's what we have. We make a joke that a scout is always ready to, is always hungry. We make it our 13th point to the scout law. And there are times when this is true. But if our scout only has his mess kit, Mr. Sean's going to be like, what are you going to sleep in? Mr. Owen's going to be like, well, what if somebody falls and breaks an ankle? Or how are you going to see to get to the bathroom in the middle of the night, right? So that's why our scouts must have all of this equipment. Verse 18, Paul says, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication to the end, keeping alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. We have to be ever mindful of those who need prayer around us. We just prayed for several individuals in and around the community who have gone through some things, some families that have lost loved ones, some people who have come through the other side of surgery, whether it be for cancer or for heart conditions. We have to pray for those, but not just those people, not those people in just our community. Pray for our pastors, pray for our deacons, our elected officials in the city, the state, the county, and the country. We must pray for them so that they are protected and helped by people who are godly people. That's all I have. I, again, do want to thank each and every one of you for joining us for Scout Sunday. We're glad that you have opened your doors to us, and we thank you.
Appreciate so much, you know, you sharing God's word with us today, and I just think that's so key. The last couple of days, I've been watching a TV show on Food Network called Tournament of Champions, and they like bring all the best chefs that you would find around the United States for this competition. And when they show up, they have no idea what they're about to cook. Like, they spin a wheel, and then you'll find out like what your meat's going to be, and they spin a wheel to find out what your vegetable's going to be, and they spin a wheel for like what cooking device you have to use as a part of cooking this thing, and they spin a wheel for what type of meal you have to prepare, and then they also spin a wheel for how much time you're going to need to do it. So you have these, you know, top chefs in the world having no clue what they're about to cook, and all of a sudden they're going to find out here. And what I've noticed every time I've watched it is as soon as they see this collection of things that they weren't sure they were going to get, but once they have all the things, the components there, and they say go, immediately they react and they have an idea for what they're going to cook for that challenge. And what I think is unique about that is that here you have these folks who they are ready. They're ready for the challenge ahead of them. And Kenneth was just sharing with us from the scriptures that we must be ready because we have an enemy who fights against his church. Amen? And if we don't have the full armor on, I like how you said it, Kenneth, like with the breastplate of righteousness, we're exposing these vital parts of our soul. And so I want to say that today because in praying, like for some of us, if we find that we are fighting, that we're losing kind of our spiritual battle today, that we find ourselves choosing to move more into like what we want rather than what God wants. If we find that right now we find like just different heartaches and struggles in our lives, part of that might be is because we've not dressed ourselves in the full armor of the Lord. We've exposed ourselves. Satan's going to tempt us no matter what. Right, church? if I am dressed and ready to acknowledge that when that temptation comes, that it's from the devil, and that it is not what's going to honor God, and I'm going to capture it as the Word of God says, I'm going to submit it to the Word of God, the Spirit of Truth, and in that, I'm going to stand firm, what we heard today, in the strength that God gives us to live in the victory of Christ Jesus, then just like we heard in the Scriptures and through the sermon, the enemy's going to attack, but we're prepared to deflect what comes against us and stand strong after it through the strength that comes from the Lord. So I want to encourage us in that today. Let me invite you to take your hymnals as we close today. We're going to stand together. We're going to sing a wonderful chorus. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. 328. Let's stand together as we worship the Lord. 328 as we close in worship here today. We're going to sing this through two times. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let's worship the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Amen. Again, let me invite you, if you wouldn't mind, to go stand by that front door so folks have a chance to meet you and talk with you for a moment. Church family, let me pray with us here. We just exalt you, Lord. We thank you today for the wonderful, free opportunity, the freedom we have, Lord, to worship you. It comes at a cost, Lord, of much sacrifice that has been given and still given today for the freedom that we have. So, Lord, we thank you today for the blessing to worship you. We thank you for the message of God we received today through your servant, Kenneth. And we pray, Lord, that as you lead us this week, lead us to be those who are dressed and ready for battle, knowing that you have won the victory, and that, Lord, we will come through victorious as we allow you to fight the battle, and we stand in the strength of your absolute truth, of your word of life, of your salvation, of faith and righteousness, Lord, and the peace that you give us to always trust in you. We pray this blessing today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.